Well, I want to thank you for being here. This is the culmination of one phase of a broad coalition to safeguard our civil liberties, in particular the First, Fourth, and Fifth Amendments. In many ways, this is an unprecedented move forward by journalists, by free press advocates, by citizens across the country, transcending any party divisions, to insist that we as Americans have a right to freedom of the press. Now, this petition here is not the end of anything. It's the beginning. Those 100,000 people who signed the petition are not just names on a piece of paper or on a computer screen. They're a core of a citizens' movement that we're in touch with at rootsaction.org. We can reach them on a few minutes' notice via email. And we have every intention, in coalition with many groups around the country, to escalate this fight to defend freedom of the press. Like many thousands of journalists around the country, I've known since I was a teenager that you do not betray your confidential sources. And as the petition points out, the First Amendment cannot survive in practice if journalists cannot safeguard the confidentiality of their sources. The reality is that if only official stories can be told, then the First Amendment will be gutted. And the only way that we get unofficial stories is if journalists and their sources know that whistleblowers can have their confidentiality protected. Now, Attorney General Holder has said on more than one occasion that he doesn't think a journalist should go to jail for doing his or her job. The question is, does a journalist's job include ratting on his or her sources? And it's clear that any journalist, all journalists worth their salt, understand that part of your job is to protect your sources, not betray them. And that is a reality that gives oxygen to the First Amendment. We have an administration that seems determined to sit on, with the full weight of these bureaucracies, the windpipe of the First Amendment. This petition and the now 20 Pulitzer Prize winners who have issued independent individual statements this week in support of James Risen are insisting that choking off the oxygen to the First Amendment is absolutely unacceptable. Now, there are many people in many walks of life, including the signers of this petition, who are resolute and passionate, understanding and asserting that protecting freedom of the press is essential to prospects for democracy. And I'm very glad to introduce to you someone who will be speaking as well at the news conference at 1 o'clock this afternoon, Phil Donahue.
Thank you, Norman. I'm here because whistleblowers do us no good if the people can't hear the whistle. And without reporters like James Risen, they'll never hear the whistle. We have a media that really has a lot to account for. Every major metropolitan newspaper in this country supported the invasion of Iraq. This was the rah-rah, go-along, steno, take the handout journalistic class that we had during the run-up to the Iraq War. James Risen is different. James Risen rose above us all and did the hard work. He didn't go to the top where you get the most spin. He went to the middle and the bottom where you get the most truth. So at a time when the American media has so much explanation to do, we should be supporting James Risen. We want to put him on a pedestal, and the people in this building want to put him in prison. What's wrong with this picture? I'm proud to stand here with other people of conscience who believe in the First Amendment and believe that you've got to stick your nose under the tent to find out what these grandees, these people in power, are preparing for us. To find out what is the intelligence agencies, what are the intelligence agencies really doing? This is what Risen did. This is what all of us should aspire to, who presume to tell the people what's the truth. Thank you.
So I wonder if you have any questions for Phil or myself. I should add that Wynn Hornbuckle, the spokesperson from the Public Affairs Office of the Department of Justice, told me that right at 11 o'clock, he or somebody else from the department will be able to come out and accept these petitions. And so I wonder if there are any questions at this point. Yes. The question is whether the Justice Department has given any indication that they will take into account this petition. And we've gotten basically no response from the Justice Department other than saying that they will physically carry those almost 4,000 pages into the building. Any other questions for Phil or myself? Okay, then hearing none, you know, we're awaiting pretty much any minute the representative of the DOJ to come on out. And so thanks for being here, and we'll hand over in just a few minutes. Oh, okay.
Can you explain the charges against Risen? What is going on with this case?
Well, basically what's going on with this case is that the U.S. Department of Justice is insisting that James Risen should betray his source, that he should name a name as a source of information that was contained in Risen's book, State of War, published in 2006, a chapter about a botched CIA operation that occurred in the year 2000 inside or in Austria related to Iran. And Mr. Risen has run out of appeals, including to the U.S. Supreme Court, and the ball is now really in the court of Attorney General Eric Holder. Is he going to insist on demanding testimony from James Risen in terms of his source? And if the Attorney General insists on demanding that testimony from Mr. Risen, then it's highly likely that he would find either imprisonment or daily harsh fines imposed upon him. And to give you an idea of what I mean by harsh, the law provides for $5,000 a day. Now, for some of the people that President Obama hangs out with, maybe $5,000 a day wouldn't seem like much. But for a working journalist like James Risen with a family, clearly a fine of $5,000 a day, which could go on indefinitely, is coercive, to say the least. Imprisonment is also a real option. So the disposition of this conflict is now really up to the Department of Justice and really up to, let's be frank, the Obama administration. James Risen has been consistent. He's been clear. He will not betray his source. And that's where we are right now.
What
Well, investigative journalism, I think, would be further badly damaged if the Justice Department persists in this misguided and anti-democratic policy. Phil, do you want to add something on that score in terms of journalism and implications involved?
We have over, well, I won't try to, we have thousands and thousands of Americans who have a top security clearance. And they don't necessarily work for the government. This is, intelligence is farmed out to private companies. I mean, who's spying on who? And why are we so frightened? And how is it that the press remains so silent while the bedrock of this nation was chipped away? That's why we need whistleblowers, and we need journalists who work for editors brave enough to print what they say. I became a journalist in 1959. I didn't take a test. I didn't pee in a bottle. I just said, I'm a journalist. I worked for WABJ in Adrian, Michigan, the proverbial 250-watt station. We had a signal that went across the street. But I was the news director because I was the only person in the news department. I had a Norelco tape recorder with vacuum tubes. And I covered my first murder in Adrian. I covered City Hall, the police department. I couldn't get over how much power I had. I was 21 years old. I must have looked 12. And I realized how important journalism was. The reason I could become a journalist, because if that's the way you become a journalist, you're going to have a lot of journalists. And somewhere in the center of this very large crowd, you are more likely to find the truth. Today, that center is occupied by five multinational companies. Billion-dollar companies, much more concerned about the price of their stock than they are about the James Risens who might pursue a story that goes nowhere. Investigative journalism is not necessarily profit-making. That's why we don't have enough of it. And by the way, those companies don't want to do what journalists are supposed to do. They don't want to rock the boat. Those companies are the boat. So corporate media is squelching, killing our democracy, suppressing news that we ought to have to ensure that we don't ever again stand there mute while a bring it on, rootin' tootin' shootin' president takes a country into a meaningless war that now, with Afghanistan and Iraq together, has killed more than 6,000 of our young men and women, not to mention millions of refugees and uncounted injuries. This is why we need more James Risens, not fewer. And the last thing we want to do is put these brave journalists and their editors and the newspapers they work for in jail. We need them now more than ever. We can have any kind of country you want. I happen to believe the framers had the better idea. And it won't last if we can't support a free press.
And now I'm glad to introduce to you the policy advocate for, yes, I'd like to introduce to you the policy advocate for the Committee to Protect Journalists, Courtney Radsch.
Thank you. The Committee to Protect Journalists is deeply concerned about the ongoing efforts to subpoena James Risen to reveal his confidential sources and calls on the Department of Justice to withdraw the subpoena. It's deeply troubling that a democracy, a strong democracy like the United States, is putting at risk the the idea of putting Jim Risen in prison for his refusal to reveal his confidential source. The ability to keep sources confidential is central to the practice of journalism, and it's very difficult for journalists to be able to do their job, which is upholding our democracy, ensuring that the government is transparent and accountable, if they're not allowed to keep their sources confidential. I don't think that the United States wants to join Cuba in being the only country in the Western Hemisphere to have a journalist in prison, but that is what's at risk if this subpoena continues. And I think it's important that the government balance its various interests, the interests in protecting its citizens and defending national security, with the interest in upholding democratic processes and the rights of the press, which is so central to a democracy as the Fourth Estate, and the ability to talk with sources confidentially and not be at risk of having to reveal those sources is central to that. So again, the Committee to Protect Journalists calls on the Department of Justice to immediately withdraw the subpoena and allow James Risen to go back to his very important job of covering national security and ensuring that we can hold this government accountable. Thank you.
So in approximately 8 minutes, the Justice Department is scheduled to formally accept the petition. And I think you each have a print of the first page of it, which gives you a flavor. The signers are still coming in online, but we had to go ahead and print these out, a little over 100,000 signers here. And so in a few minutes, we will formally transfer this. I should say that we hope that people, the Justice Department, will actually read the petition, because it has many, many thousands of individual personal comments from around the country and beyond. You can skip through the website online petition and you can sample them yourselves randomly. But there are, I would say, perhaps 10,000 individual comments here, and they're quite eloquent and often, I think, quite moving. So we have a few minutes till the Justice Department emerges to accept the petitions. Thanks a lot again for being here.
are you?
Pleasure. Pleasure.
How are
you doing? Today the show's on the road here. It's
yeah, good.
Be good. Very good.
Is he going to come and see you? You don't know yet.
Well, you mean Holder? Or?
No. Whoever. Don't they have something
to do with that? They promised they would come out like out of a cuckoo clock at 11 o'clock.
Thank you, sir. Okay, thank you.
Slide it over. I think that's good.